Good evening, friends, and very happy to speak to you today at the end of the financial year 2018-19 and to share with you our thoughts. I'd first like to start by giving a little perspective on the financial sector as I see it at this point of time, and then what does it mean for Kotak for the year which has gone by and for the future. First of all, I do believe that the financial sector in India, it is at a major crossroad with significant challenges and turbulence at this point of time. And it is extremely important that the next 3 to 6 months, the financial sector, both from a point of view of practitioners and policymakers, is handled in a manner which leads to smooth navigation in turbulent waters. I do believe that if you go back to the history post-2011, we saw the real sector and the problems of the real sector impacting the financial sector. We have now got to be careful that the challenges of the financial sector do not impact the real sector, because there is clearly significant challenges which we see as we stand today. And it takes me back to 2016, end of 2016 calendar, when we saw a significant change in India's financial savings scenario, which is post-demonetization. We saw a flood of financial savings coming into organized finance. And with that significant, and I think it was one of the greatest benefits to the financial sector out of the demonetization exercise, which is growth in organized financial savings. However, as organized financial savings grew, first into banks, then into mutual funds and into insurance, and then into other segments of the financial sector, which is both housing finance companies and NBFCs, we also saw behind this flood of liquidity a significant dilution to what I call as risk underwriting standards. And a lot of money went into underlying illiquid assets, and essentially a lot of assets getting wholesale funded with cheap liquidity coming in from the formal financial savings market. And some of the challenges which we have started facing post August-September 2018 are the results of liquidity or surplus money which was sloshing around in the system gradually get back, as currency in circulation also significantly increased to much higher levels, which means cash in the economy took money away from formal, organized formal finance as a system. And as this money and liquidity started getting tightened, the asset side of balance sheets started getting pressure, and some of the challenges which we are facing today come from challenges on risk underwriting, underwriting of illiquid assets, and mismatch of ALM, combined with significant part of this money being wholesale funded. I do believe that this is impacting and will continue to be a major theme for the next 3 to 6 months. And it is here that effective navigation is crucial for Indian financial sector. It also highlights something which we at Kotak have deeply believed in our entire careers and history, that in financial services, the importance of the balance sheet, and by balance sheet I mean off balance sheet items as well, to the extent that they are risk oriented, the importance of the balance sheet over short-term P&Ls. And it is here again that a long-term financial business, especially with high leverage finance, it is very crucial to ensure the quality, sustainability, liquidity, and stability of the balance sheet of financial institutions. So a continuing belief that the balance sheet is far more important than the short-term P&L account. Third, on the liability side, something which we have been almost like a crusade focused on, which is stable and low-cost retail liability is core to a financial institutional franchise. And some of the travails which we are seeing in the financial sector are coming out from a disproportionate part of balance sheet getting wholesale funding. And we have, through good times and tough times, had a relentless focus on our liability franchise. And it is here that I'm happy to report to you that as of 31st March 2019, our CASA ratio has now touched 52.5%. And we are not obsessed by a number. We would like to see it continue to grow in a systematic manner. We are also very happy to report to you that our focus on retail deposits, particularly deposits below 1 crore, has also been key. We have grown the retail deposits. I think Jaimin will have the exact numbers. But we have grown the retail deposits also by more than 30%. And this is again back to the importance of stable and sustainable liability as a core to financial services. Therefore, as this turbulence goes, we believe we at Kotak, with a well-capitalized balance sheet, a continuing focus on stable, sustainable, and low-cost retail liability as a core of our franchise, high focus on the risk underwriting side, ready to recognize problems early rather than waiting for things to happen and us being caught unawares, is the core to our philosophy and culture. And we would very much like to continue that as we go forward. We are also seeing a continuing opportunity to gain share. We are also seeing an ability to get better pricing for the risks we are taking. And that is reflected in our growth in loan book as also in our net interest margins. We are also very committed to the broader financial services business, which includes, if you would have seen our numbers, particularly in life insurance, as also in asset management businesses. I'm happy to report to you a very significant growth in embedded value of our life insurance business from 5,800 crores to 7,300 crores and a margin on new business now at 36%, which is probably the highest in the life insurance industry. We have also seen a very good growth in our asset management business. We are focused on customer assets, including our asset management business, and continuing to grow them. And at the same time, our relentless focus on pure banking as the heart of our financial services franchise continues. With these comments, I will now ask my colleague Jaimin Bhatt to take you through the facts and details of our numbers for March 2019.
Thanks, Uday. I'll just take you through the earnings update, which we have circulated a little earlier today. Let me take the first. As Uday mentioned, we closed the quarter with a profit growth of 25% for this quarter over the same period last year. This quarter, we clocked 1408 crores at the bank standalone number. Advances at the bank standalone, we crossed 2 lakh crores for the first time, and we also crossed the balance sheet total of 3 lakh crores at this period. We end the year with 1,500 branches. Our capital adequacy pretty healthy at 17.5%, with Tier 1 itself at 16.9%. On the P&L, our net interest income has grown 18% if I look at this quarter versus the same period last year, as well as if I look at this full year versus the same period last year. Our fee business has seen a decent growth. This is despite the slowdown in the mutual fund income. Our fee business overall has done this quarter versus last quarter an 18% growth, and a full year basis a 23% growth for last year. Our operating profit has done a growth of YOY 13% and a QOQ growth of 17%. We have done a step up on our provisioning, especially against advances, and for this year, we have an advances provision of 976 crores as against 743 last year. In the previous quarter, we had also given a reclassification of our P&L in the manner it would be identifiable, and on that basis, we've given the current quarter numbers also. And on that basis, if I look at the full year number, our operating profit is a year-on-year growth of about 19.5%. Our advances in the bank standalone grew by 21% on a year-on-year basis, with growth across the segments. Corporate banking grew close to 19%. CVC is about 30%. The agri division led by tractors about 18%. Small businesses about 30-odd% and home loans very bad. The business banking segment for the year as well as for the quarter remained flat. Focus on the NPA numbers. We closed the current period with a gross NPA at 2.14% against 2.22 last year and a net number of 0.75. SMA2 again at the end of the period, 138 crores, which is 0.07% of advances. Exposure, and this is exposure including non-fund and investments and whatever, to the NBFC segment has come down both in absolute terms and percentage terms over the last year. And similarly on CRE, excluding the LRD book, has come down again both in percentage and absolute terms over the last year. On the deposit front, as Uday mentioned, our continuous focus on that. CASA at 32.5%. Sweep, in addition to that, is about 6.2%. CASA plus TD less than 5 crores now constitutes 81% of our overall deposit base. The focus on TD less than 1 crore, that has grown by 32% on a year-on-year basis. If I look at my full year and average number, the current account on an average number has grown 20% on a year-on-year basis and a savings account at 38% on a year-on-year basis. Our relationship value of the wealth and priority customers that we advise is now approximately 2,70,000 crores. And as I mentioned, the balance sheet, we are in excess of 3,00,000 crores at this bank standalone. Before I take the consolidated, we'll request Shanti to take the digital slide.
Thank you, Jenny. Kotak mobile banking app continues to be one of the top-rated mobile apps in both Apple Store as well as Google Play Store. It's reflected in the 50% YOY growth in monthly incremental active users on the mobile. Out of 78% of our mobile banking customers are only mobile and not net. And 14x is the number of mobile logins versus our net. So mobile-first focus continues for Kotak. For RD and TD, digital sourcing continues to dominate. And we introduced many enhanced features on the app across products, customer service, and customer experience. Industry-first KR voice bot. 1.3 million is the monthly average interactions with KR, of which 1 million completes the fulfillment at KR voice bot itself. In terms of digital payments, we continue to overachieve digital payments target set by Niti by 110%. This is across UPI, AEPS, and BBPS. API banking, which is really the open banking where we are the pioneers, has seen a 2x growth, and our KMall is also showing a YOY growth of close to 2x. On the lending side, we continue to grow digital lending and really acquisition across credit card, personal loan, business loan, and home loan. Notable is home loan, where we have seen a 5x increase in acquiring home loans digital. And we continue to partner with FinTech to be able to provide innovative solutions for our customers. In the subsidiaries, across securities, life insurance, and general insurance, we continue the digital thrust. In securities, we've seen 121% YOY growth in mobile daily ADV, which is average daily volume. In Kotak life insurance, 94% of the banca sourcing comes through Genie. And in Kotak general insurance, we've seen a 123% growth in volume of digital business YOY. Jamin, back to you.
Thanks, Shanti. On the consolidated numbers, we closed the quarter with a profit of 2,038 crores, crossing the 2,000 number there. And for the year as a whole, the consolidated number, profit of 7,204 crores. Again, a healthy capital adequacy. We have a Tier 1 at 17.5% and an overall capital of 17.9% at the group level. Our NIM at the group level at 4.48% again, and the book value of 302 rupees, a net worth of 8,280 crores. For the year, apart from the bank, the major contributors were Kotak Prime at just short of 600 crores, the life insurance company at 507 crores, Kotak Securities at 452 crores, the mutual fund delivering 255 crores, significantly higher than the same period last year, and international subsidiaries just getting short of 150 crores. The net worth of 58,000 crores across various entities includes close to 43,000 crores in the bank. This is for the dividend for this year. Advances at the group level at 2,43,000 crores. We've seen about an 18% rise on a year-on-year basis. The non-bank level, the auto loans remaining flat both on a year-on-year and on a quarter-on-year. Uday talked about the insurance activity and the embedded value as of the end of the year at 7,306 crores, as against 5,800 last year, with a VNB margin of 136%. Of the product mix, ULIP constituting just around 25%, and the bank bringing in about 48% of the total premiums of the insurance company. Gross total premium in the insurance has grown by close to 24%, and we end the year with a solvency of 3.02 against a requirement of 1.5. Kotak Securities ended the year with 452 gross profit post-tax, and the quarter at 111 gross. Market share at 2.6%, but the cash market share at 9.1% for the year. Kotak Capital has been in the middle of several deals in the quarter, both on IPOs, blocks, buybacks, and advisory, and clocked the year with a post-tax profit of 63 crores. Assets under management across the group at 2,25,000 crores, 23% up from the same period last year. In the quarter, we closed a special situations fund in asset fees of over $500 million. The asset management company improving the profitability and including its share of the equity AUM now at 5.52% against 4.8 last year, and an overall market share of 6.13 against 5.4 last year. Kotak Prime having a total book of about 28,000 crores, which 20,000 plus is in the passenger car segment. A net profit post-tax of 599 for the year. Healthy capital adequacy at 19.4 and a ROA of 2.2. Kotak Investments, lending book of 9,000 plus crores in the year. Profit of over 200 crores. Capital of 18.4 and ROA of 3% for the year. That broadly the highlights of the group and for the year. And open to questions.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone phone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to limit their questions to two per participant. Time permitting, you may come back in the queue for a follow-up. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sri Karthik from Investec Capital. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I wanted to ask a question on our SA growth. So when we look at our CASA per branch, we're probably at industry best levels. So how should one look at the overall liabilities momentum in this context?
I'll ask my colleague Shanti to give her perspective. Shanti, over to you.
So there are two aspects to it. One is a function, SA growth basically is a function of one, constant customer acquisition, and second is deepening. As you may remember, in the last 2 years, we've seen a tremendous movement in our customer base, which we continue to deepen for savings. And in the physical two branches, both from NTB as well as deepening, we have been able to very successfully grow our SA franchise. So I think you've got to look at this digital model, which has really worked for us in the last 2 years. And we continue to focus on acquiring and deepening our savings balances.
So with the current run rate of branch additions, which is obviously lower than our overall SA growth, you'd expect the current SA momentum to sustain going forward?
So the way I look at it is that our branches are in localities where the opportunity is far deeper and wider than what we are. So there is an opportunity even within where we are located to continue to deepen SA. And as you may have seen, we have continued to grow the network. We grew the network, and we will continue to grow the network in a calibrated manner based on where we see is the opportunity. So I think you have to look at metrics beyond just SAP or branch and look at how you can deepen and widen the markets around you. Right.
You know, Andy, I think what the answer is 1 + 1 = 2. That is the core of what we are learning, which is a combination of branch plus digital. And the ability, I think, therefore, we think there's a lot more legs to go in the SAP acquisition. The car piece requires more branch network. SAP piece, as long as there's a branch in a reasonable density, that combined with digital is a very effective way of doing SAP. Therefore, we are not constrained by our current percentages. We just, as we said, we are obsessed with continuing to focus on stable and low-cost liability, and there is no upper limit to which we are concerned with.
Sure, sir. And just one data-keeping question around our small businesses, PL and credit cards line item that we disclosed. Any further breakup that you could provide between the three?
Honestly, that's one number which is overall for the three businesses put together. They operate pretty much within the consumer bank as one. So not really giving the breakup of what in each of them.
Sure. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vishal Goyal from UBS Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Congratulations on good set of numbers. I think especially on life insurance, I think that makes you almost the most profitable, you know, insurance company. Is it possible to get some more breakdown of the EV movement? Because, you know, we can see one leg, which is the VNB, and probably we can even, you know, derive the EV unwinding. But are there any other parts where you are seeing positive variance? You know, we're just basically more interested in that.
Gaurang?
See, I think when on an investment side you do better than compared to how you have discounted the future cash flows, perhaps that leads to the unwinding of VNB versus the actual. So in terms of profitability, as you say, increasing profitability in real terms, that 507 crore post-tax profit, it generates out of that. Otherwise, you know, it's like a huge reconciliation. So we don't provide the details, but we have just started giving you the overall numbers. So last year we gave you both the EV as well as margins. This year we have given you the embedded value at the end of the period. So I think over a period of time we'll see that what all can be added.
All that I can share is that we really like our life insurance business.
And the other thing is the cost efficiency is also increasing, plus to Kotak Bank, which is our, as Jaimin mentioned, we have a 46% to 48% distribution. We pay only IRDA commission, so that also perhaps helps us in terms of higher margin. And again, on the same way, on a credit term business, where, you know, we've got a large mortgage and LAP business, on which when you sell the credit cover, there also the IRDA payment of commission is very low. And both these aspects also helps us in terms of our higher margin and profitability.
Okay, thank you. And the other question, sir, I think is about, I think you were talking about the climate and, you know, the environment being still very basically problematic in some sense. So is there a second round of, you know, NPL cycle which, you know, we should all expect, especially coming from the promoter groups? Is that what you're alluding to, or you're talking still about the SMEs?
So I think, as I said, for the first time you're seeing interplay between challenges in the real sector and the financial sector. And so far, you know, if you look at, if you and I were talking 1 year ago, we were all sanguine about potential stress coming from the financial sector itself. All that I'm saying is, in turbulent times, don't be sanguine about anything. Okay?
Yeah, no, no. So I think, when you say, I mean, so financial sector, I mean, is that about NBFCs and all the ancillaries around, you know, financial services? Is that, you know, basically the next leg of problem you're looking at?
I'm just saying that you have to be, risk underwriting is risk underwriting, whether I'm giving money to a real sector company or a financial sector company. My underwriting standards have to be sure to be taking care of what is my credit cost for the risk I'm taking and what are the returns I'm making. So there is risk in everything, not just the real sector. That's all I'm saying. And it is very important for any financial institution to risk underwriting, pricing and measurement, irrespective of whether the counterparty is real sector or financial sector.
Okay, thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rahul Jain from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good evening, Uday and the team. A couple of questions. First of all, Uday, on the macro question and, you know, extending it from what Vishal was asking you, with regards to the NBFCs, we have seen, you know, slew of, you know, ratings downgrade happen, and clearly the funding seems to have, again, you know, gotten dislocated. Do you worry about a second derivative, you know, playing out in the broader financial sector as a result of which the macro will also have to take a knock-on? Logically, you know, one would like to, you know, think that way, but clearly with the slew of rating downgrades that have happened in the last couple of months, how are you reading the overall space and how do you think we resolve this space, as in this problem?
Rahul, I think it's, I mean, the macro questions are something which we need to focus on. And my view is one of the areas which minority shareholders, debt holders, stakeholders depend disproportionately on is what I call as external fiduciaries.
Mm-hmm.
And these external fiduciaries can be auditors, rating agencies, supervisors, independent directors, call it by whatever name, different roles, but essentially I would club all these in the category of what I call as external fiduciaries.
Uh-huh.
And I am clear that when we are underwriting and whenever we are looking at underwriting in the current context in India, I would be very careful in disproportionately depending on external fiduciaries for my credit judgments.
Got it. And therefore, you expect some
No, I'm not making any expectation. I'm saying when we are lending money, we have to lend money on what we think makes sense for risk and return. There is too much of lending in the financial sector which depends on external fiduciaries for our credit judgments disproportionately.
Understood.
Inevitably have to rely on them to a certain extent because audited accounts and things like that. But please use your diligence. Please use your nose. Please don't take anything at face value. Ask the difficult questions internally before putting out risk. And I think we are at this crucial juncture in the financial sector where in many ways the role of the external fiduciaries is under a challenge and we need to ask the tough questions before putting out our money. Because if our money goes bad, just because there was some view given by an external fiduciary will not protect our money. And that is the most important point which we are learning in the last 6 to 8 months.
Got it. That takes me to another question of about credit cost. Now, in this quarter, actually, that, you know, it came in, you know, relatively, you know, at a healthy rate. I guess, you know, over the last few years, we have been consistently bringing down our credit cost. So that combined with your macro view, do you see any risk to this number or there's further scope for the improvement?
Our view is that we would like to see it moderately come down, or we think it should remain same or moderately come down.
Got it. The second question is around the liability, you know, franchise, and you know, kudos to you and your team. And we saw that you cut savings rate to on you know, deposits less than 1 lakh rupees and all. How would this translate into the margins? Would you choose to pass it on to the borrowers and therefore, you know, have a much better risk selection, or you would actually pass it on to the shareholders? How do you see that play out?
The first point is pretty clear. We have not changed our deposit rates for any depositor between 1 lakh and 1 crore. That is still at 6%. Let me reiterate, 6% stands between 1 lakh and 1 crore. We have not changed it. We would love to see our savings account depositors who are below 1 lakh to actually go above 1 lakh. Okay?
Okay.
And we would, therefore, one of our big focus areas is how do we deepen SA balances per account? So that is a relentless focus, and the decision which we have taken actually strengthens our desire and effort and execution to get more monies into savings accounts with our bank. So that is a very clear strategic positioning which we want to do. Okay, get customers to put more than 1 lakh and get 6%. Okay. On the other hand, of course, we, for balances below 1 lakh, if we have moved from 5 to 4.5, we see some shareholder benefits. We would continue to be focused on growing our consumer franchise. Therefore, if it means we need to get more spend into debit cards, into credit cards, or getting consumers to be more sticky with us, we will certainly do that. But that is for ultimately growing shareholder value. But our strategy for dropping from 5 to 4.5 is not only about immediate short-term P&L, but more strategic stickiness of our customers and growing our franchise stronger.
Got it. Just one last question on the growth in small business and personal loans. It's been fairly, you know, healthy at about 30-35%. One of the large banks recently said that, you know, they are consciously going slow on this portfolio. Of course, your size is much smaller and therefore there's still a scope for you to keep gaining market share. But are you seeing any early, you know, warning signs across the industry, you know, in this portfolio? And should we be sort of, you know, also cognizant of this you know, fact, or how do you see this portfolio play out for you guys?
In fact, I think, Rahul, in the last quarter or quarter before that, I had mentioned about the fact that we have to watch out unsecured consumer lending very carefully. So we have grown the book, we are watching it very closely. We think this is a time to be watchful. But at the same time, what is also happening is that the marketplace has suddenly seen some of the larger players, including from the NBFC sector, slow down. So there is more space.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much, Sudha. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Shah from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi. Good evening. Firstly, in terms of the overall CBC portfolio, if you look at it, we have still grown quite strongly quarter on quarter as well as year on year, despite the industry rates. Is it really we are gaining the market share and taking away the market share from few of the NBFCs as well? And how do we look at it given the underlying slowdown in the states, maybe the overall industry?
My colleague Kannan will answer. He handles the commercial bank.
Yeah, on the CBC segment, especially on the CE segment, we've gained quite a bit of market share. So also on the CV segment. Yes, there was a bit of a slowdown in the last few months. But post-elections, we don't expect it to continue. We expect the growth to continue till about December before the market moves on to BS6. So we do expect post-elections, the growth to come back. There was a bit of a slowdown in the last couple of months.
Okay. And particularly with respect to the deposits, so given that the currency in circulation is still hovering slightly on a higher side, RBI is taking all the measures to infuse liquidity. But finally, in terms of the deposit rates, how do we look at the industry, particularly on the term deposit side, with the stance of the monetary policy almost like 50-odd basis points cut? So do we see it on the downside, or maybe given where the CD ratios are of the private banks, we see it at the elevated levels?
I don't see much room for downside on deposit rates from here. Because finally, there is a demand for bank deposits. Having said that, I must also mention one point. There is some movement of money coming back to bank deposits away from other pieces of the financial sector. And therefore, banks are getting some flow of deposits coming from other areas of financial savings.
Yeah, but structurally, if we look at it over the last 4-5 years, the share of deposits have actually been coming down. So maybe in the transition, or maybe what we had seen in terms of what NBFCs are going through, that would be the trend. But structurally, if we look at it in terms of the proportion of the financial savings, deposits have been more or less stable in the absolute term. So do that really suggest that deposit rates would move on further despite maybe RBI cutting the rates, and given that we are say gaining the market share both on the savings as well as the term deposit side, what would be our stance on say our own deposit rate?
A lot depends in terms of what RBI does on policy rates and the liquidity in the system for us to be able to take a view on where the deposit rates are. Therefore, as we get clarity on RBI's position both on further rate from here, whether they reduce or not, as well as the liquidity available in the system, will drive deposit rates. But I have to actually come back to a very fundamental point in the financial industry. Raising liability is excruciating hard work over long periods of time. Okay? And if any of us believe that is the easy part, let me assure you, it is the toughest part of the financial services franchise. And you need to be doing hard work year after year, day after day, to really keep on growing that franchise. And that is something my team is completely committed to. Deposit, retail, stable, sustainable franchise. On the other side, on the asset piece, a relentless surgical focus on risk for the returns we get and ability to say no to risk for returns is the other part of the equation. And at some level, if these two parts are reasonably done, and of course, then you do a sprinkling of fees coming from different sources, there's a financial services business.
Okay. And lastly, in terms of the slippages for the quarter and any of the pockets wherein we would have seen a relatively higher stress this quarter compared to the first 9 months of FY19?
Well, Jamie?
Not particularly. It's across the board, but as we spoke about earlier, we've seen some of that unsecured ones happening, but it's not significantly spiking anything.
And how much would
overall it is? Overall, there is no chunky hit. It is well distributed.
Okay. And slippages for the quarter?
You know, sir, the quarter number for the year, we will be at 1995, which is against
okay.
About 1860, same period last year, for the last year.
Sorry, last year
would have been 1860. And this
okay,
year
1860
would,
and this year is 1995. Okay. Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prakash Sharma from CLSA. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for taking my question and congratulations. Looks good to see, you know, very strong numbers. I just wanted to get a little more clarity on the corporate book just to understand it a little better. And I'm kind of referring to slide 5 and 6 of your disclosures. What I wanted to understand is, you know, slide 5 just shows 30% of the book is corporate banking at a standalone bank. And slide 6, you have provided some Basel III disclosures on NBFC, CRE and LRD. I believe obviously this will be on a consolidated basis, but broadly, even if I take that out of the 278,000 crores of consolidated exposures, these three sectors are constituting to something like 7% of total, or maybe 8. And broadly, this adds up to like 24% of the corporate book. If I'm assuming 30% of 278,000 crore is corporate book. So I'm trying to understand that, is it correct to understand that these three sectors could be almost 25 to 30% of your corporate book? And how do you look at the book when you have three sectors constituting this large? Thank you.
If I look at the total advances at the bank, and these numbers, both 5 and 6 are at the bank standalone level, not the consolidated level.
Okay.
The bank standalone advances are 2,05,000 crores, which is on slide 5. And slide 6 talks about 2,78,000, which is total exposure. Now, exposure will include non-fund, exposure will include investments and everything which is exposure to a sector. So it's the same 2,05,000 if I include all the exposure, that is 2,78,000. So it's not necessarily correct to say that 11 plus 4 plus 4, which is about 19,000, 20,000, is 20,000 as percentage of 50,000. I don't have the exact proportion, but it is exactly 7-odd% of the total book of the bank, which is at 2,78,000. So
yeah,
that is.
And if I do a third of it being corporate, then eventually we'll get to something like a 21% or
no,
something
no, no.
like that.
No. I let me just explain. Jamin, correct me if I'm wrong. 2,05,000 is the loans and advances book.
That's the funded loans and
advances. Funded loans and advances. 2,78,000 is loans and advances plus off-balance sheet exposure plus debentures.
That's investments, yeah. Okay.
Okay. So bulk of the debentures and off-balance sheet exposures like LCs and all would be in the corporate side.
Yeah.
So of the delta of 2,05,000 and 2,78,000, the largest portion will go into the corporate side.
So your denominator actually is much larger on the corporate side for this delta between 2,05,000 and 2,78,000.
Okay.
So your percentage actually will be lower if it is out of 2,78,000 versus what it is out of 2,05,000.
Got it.
Second, you got to keep in mind that lease rent discounting is across the sectors, not only corporate.
Got it.
LRDP.
Right.
So our absolute exposures to these sectors are nowhere near the number which this calculation which you mentioned.
Got it. Second, is it possible to give your own cut of the corporate book across rating profile, your own book?
We have not been doing it. We'll keep it in mind, but I mean, for whatever it is worth, let me tell you one thing. Our risk-weighted assets have actually... Manian, why don't you do that?
All I can tell you, we have not been disclosing the RWA numbers, I think, but all I can tell you is our RWA numbers on the corporate book have been declining over the quarter to quarter almost. They have been declining over the last 2 to 3 years.
No, that, frankly, I fully appreciate. You've done very well to manage reported stress or what reported risk as well as, you know, inside the book. So just wanted to get a little more clarity. As a part of data keeping question, can I have the RWA number for standalone balance sheet?
We'll ask Jamin to look at it.
I'll give it to you. I don't...
No worries. Thank you. That's not as important. Thank you so much for clarifying.
We will have a view on that and do it. Do what is what Jamin can. Okay?
Yeah, I'll give it to you. Maybe non.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Modi from Asit C. Mehta. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question. My first question is at CASA. If I'm right, the CASA is excellent good, 52%. Now, my query is that if it's 52%, I know the impact on interest is quite low. But if you have a CASA of 52%, wouldn't you require high liquidity coverage ratio and some of your funds have to be sort of locked in high liquid assets, except CRR, SLR? Or am I missing a point? My question is, do you want to keep it at high or if you're okay for even lower?
I'll ask Gaurang, who also looks after risk in the bank, to give you just a little bit of understanding on how liquidity coverage ratio is done from a behavioral point of view.
Yeah, I think key is the behavior, like how your CASA year on year is showing what pattern of behavior. So that leads to kind of, you know, working out the LCR.
So there's a core CA and there's a core SA which comes out of behavior, which is
not in the first bucket.
Which is not in the first bucket.
And therefore, LCR is not.
In fact, as you are asking on LCR, we are currently at a LCR of 115.
Okay, means I just want to know whether you are looking.
Let me explain to you, out of CA and SA, what LCR requires you to do is to look at core CA and core SA from a behavioral point of view. That is considered not in the first bucket for liquidity purposes. Okay?
Hello?
Prakash, just to answer your question, RW at the bank is about 2,35,000 crores.
Okay, next question.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ravi Singh from HSBC. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, Jamin. Just wanted a clarification on slide number 7, where average SA and average CA growth rates are discussed. So these numbers are different from what is given in the press release, and press release numbers are more consistent with what given in previous quarters.
What is there on slide 7 is the average for the year.
Okay.
So the year was this, we are in quarter 4, so what we talked about is on this slide is the average for the year and not just for the quarter.
Got it. And could you also provide standalone bank RWA same March last year? So 235 is this year. What was this number last year?
199.
Okay, thank you. And just one final question, I mean, more qualitative flavor around. So our cost to assets at around 2.7%, if you benchmark with other banks, is on higher side. So just wanted to understand what will be attributing the higher cost to asset. Is it higher effort intensity on the liability side or the additional effort on the asset side in terms of credit teams and recovery team, which is reflecting in higher, better credit costs?
It is both, and it depends on the mix of your assets also. If you have a higher proportion of retail, the costs do tend to be higher. If you have a higher proportion of wholesale, the costs tend to be lower.
Okay. But in general, OPEX growth has picked up pace in last two quarters. So what are the factors driving that higher OPEX growth?
Now, if you look at one is, of course, we did advertising spend, plus of the fact that there are certain items which are showing increase in OPEX cost, but also leading to higher revenue happening. For example, we have an arrangement as a business correspondent to source microfinance, so that's adding to our costs and also adding to expenses. A lot of credit card related expenses are adding to cost, but also giving us a higher income. Similarly, POS or e-com and whatnot are giving us higher cost, but also leading to higher incomes. So the cost on a standalone basis would look higher compared to what was there, but it is all of these are corresponding to giving us higher income at the same time. Yeah, so all of these are kind of variable costs, which are also kind of giving us revenue. The only other thing, which is a small amount of that, we've started doing consumer durable activity in the bank, so that's led to some cost this time, which was not there in the previous year.
Fair enough. Thanks for this.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ravi Naredi from Naredi Investments. Please go ahead. Ravi, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with your questions. As there is no response, we move to the next question from the line of Mona Khetan from Reliance Securities. Please go ahead.
My questions have been answered. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kabir Gulati from HL Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Actually, just wanted to understand. I see a bit disconnect between the NII growth, sequential NII growth, and the increase in margin that have been reported. The absolute growth in NII and the increase in ratio NII.
Okay. We take that. If you look at NII, it comes from a combination of both advances growth and investments growth. In this particular quarter, you've seen advances as a proportion of what's happening as an overall interest-earning assets. Advances are a higher proportion than investments. And in advances does bring us higher yields compared to investments by a mile. So the sharper increase in the advances growth compared to a muted increase in the investments, actually, if I look at my average investments on a quarter-on-quarter sequentially, average earning investments have dropped compared to the previous quarter, whereas advances have grown decently. And advances getting me the higher top line has led to the NIM going up higher.
NIM.
But the day-end balances does not show this, actually, because the other items other than advances too seems to have grown in line with that one.
What you earn, therefore I was giving you average numbers, what you earn is on averages and not on EOP numbers. If I look at advances, my yield on advances has grown during the current period, whereas investments has grown, but that's a smaller proportion.
Yeah, I understand. So maybe during the quarter, the numbers would have been much less than what they are being reported at the end.
So if I look at my average advances, it has been on a year-on-year basis about 23% growth as against 21% for a period end. And again, if I look at for the quarter, my average advances would have grown by about 4.7% as against a smaller number on a quarter-on-quarter EOP.
Yeah, I get through it. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saurabh Kumar from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Sir, just on this prime thing, your book has still not grown. I mean, what's the view incrementally you are forming there? And secondly,
tell me you'll sell more cars and we will go prime faster.
But I mean, sir, if you compare this to other even NBFCs or even banks which have auto loans.
I grant you, but Kotak Mahindra Prime does not do businesses which compete with the bank. It is focused on car finance. Okay, so whatever we can do in the bank, we are doing in the bank. We are our approach is a little different, and therefore Kotak Mahindra Prime, the biggest piece in Kotak Mahindra Prime is the car finance business.
Okay. So, granted that given where we are in the market, this book will then continue to be very slow.
Yeah.
Will that be
but
fair comment?
Time, at the same time, if you look at it, we have managed this book with a pretty good situation, keeping in mind that the car industry, including car dealers, are under significant pressure.
Yeah. And so the LTVs here would be what, sub 80% or...
LTV will be more than that.
It will
be about 90%.
New cars.
This is the average
for a prime, right?
Yeah.
That's right. The new cars will be high, but the used cars will be much lower.
Yeah, fair. Okay. And this is the second question on business banking. So that book has still not grown. I mean, so that view which you had on this segment, that still continues or is it likely to change?
It's getting better. It's better. I think we have, we believe we are bottoming out and we should see better growth next year.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rahul Maheshwari from TCG Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Good set of numbers. My two questions are there. First, on agri portfolio, as one of the larger bank had told that post-elections they will see the portfolio, how it's panning out. So in your book, as post-elections, do you find any contingency to be provided for the agri portfolio? And what is the nature which in your agri portfolio has been panned out during the quarter and last 6 months and going forward post-elections where you find first thing? Second, as you were the first to highlight to be cautious on SME portfolio in the industry, any other segment where you find cautiousness for next 6 months to 1 year because of the liquidity tightening, or you as a bank would be cautious for not growing and let first the things get settled and then we'll look at the further picture?
Okay, on agri, if there was any pain which we saw coming or which we saw on our book, we would provide for it. Or we would not wait for the elections to provide for it. Just rest assured on that. Okay. And on how the portfolio is looking at this stage, we think we are in reasonable shape. We had seen some spottiness about a year ago, so we have taken corrective measures, and I think we are in reasonable shape on the agri portfolio at this stage of the cycle. And we are not... unless there is a big disaster on monsoon, which we don't know. But at this stage, we are not seeing anything dramatically worrying in our agri portfolio.
Any contingency provision on agri portfolio has been created?
No, we think we are adequately provided in terms of what we require. And second question is on sector which we are worried. I think we are worried about across the group lending against residential real estate and land.
Okay, so in your home loan and LAP, which is 20%...
No, when I say residential real estate, I mean wholesale, CRE.
Okay.
Developer. So
that's just 1.6 or something percentage. So in that, it's a well... the lending is to well-rated exposure in your... as per the segment.
We believe that our... we have been pretty choosy about lending in real estate. And therefore, we think we are in reasonable shape. But we have all of us have to watch the cycle.
And just last, out of the home loan and LAP which you combine together and give as a 20% roughly, what is the LAP component and where you find as a LAP? Because many of the bankers in previous quarter also had slowed down in the LAP portfolio. So business segment has started picking up in the specific LAP segment?
Uldushan.
Yeah, so approximately the portfolio is about 50-50, but if you look at the growth track, home loans has been higher than LAP for this period.
And how's the LAP portfolio performing in terms of?
Stable.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Roshan Chutki from ICICI Prudential Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much for taking my question. Firstly, if you could give a, talk a little bit about your incentive system for the in the for the liabilities team.
At junior levels it's more variabilized. At senior levels it's based on discretion, culture, weightage for behavior, conduct, customer experience, NPS score, and based on that we give incentives. Because if NPS scores are low, that impacts the kind of incentives we pay. Because we do care about customer experience as an important part of how we compensate our people.
Okay. And particularly on car growth, while banks at an overall level are struggling in terms of car, our car growth has been pretty strong over the last three quarters in particular. Any reason? What are we doing different from the system? If you can talk a little bit about that.
We don't know what the system is doing. We are doing what we think will get us more cars. And we have also, for example, we have now started doing merchant acquiring and all that, which is also helping us in growth of car.
And how does, on products per customer, how has it trended in the last few quarters?
Which one?
Products per customer, how has that number moved, say, over the last three, 4 quarters?
It has continuously been improvising. You know that we have grown our customer base exponentially. Despite that, our GPH has kept on, inching upwards on it. You think product holding per customer?
And any views on the FTV cycle? How are you rating that?
From?
What cycle?
Sorry, we missed it.
MHCV cycle.
I think Kannan answered that question. Yeah. That there's a little bit of slowdown, but we think it picks up after the election, provided monsoons are normal, and will continue like that till December.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was the last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Uday Kotak for closing comments.
Thank you very much, friends and colleagues. We at Kotak continue to see steady, sustained growth as we look at this current year. We do believe that we should get to 20% plus growth, decent part of it coming out of growth in share and market share. We think there is reasonable ability to price risk as we go forward, and we feel cautiously optimistic as we look at the outlook from a Kotak point of view in a SAC sector which we believe will be turbulent, and navigation will be key. Thank you very much.
Thank you.